If you've been following the Alabama Crimson Tide for a long, long time, then nothing stirs your blood more than the rambling wreck of Georgia Tech. 52 times Alabama played Tech, 27 of those games while both were members of a Southeastern Conference. A great many of those classics match Coach Bear Bryant against Tech legend Bobby Dodd. In 1959, the Tide hosted the Texters in Birmingham and came away with a 9-7 victory, the second straight year that Bryant's team had beaten a Dodd team. Bama's legendary quarterback Pat Trammell led the way in 59. He was the Tide's leader in both rushing and passing. And who can forget Marlon Scooter Dias? He was Trammell's favorite target, and he led the Tide in scoring. The defense was strong, pitching four shutouts behind stars like Billy Neighbors and Leroy Jordan. Those were some of the leaders of a 1960 team, which was building toward a national title in 1961. But in 60, Bama won eight games. None more memorable than a come-from-behind victory at Georgia Tech. Truly one of Bama's greatest games.
The Alabama Sports Network and the Paul W. Bryant Museum present Bama's Greatest Games.
Welcome to Bama's Greatest Games. I'm Tom Roberts, and with us is former Bama and pro quarterback Jeff Rutledge. Jeff, we're going back to 1960 Alabama and Georgia Tech, and there was a time when just the mention of those two in the same sentence would just bring everybody's blood to a boil.
I think a lot like Alabama and Auburn, probably a little more intense at that time.
This particular game featured a competition between two of the better head coaches of all time, Bear Bryant for Alabama, Bobby Dodd for Georgia Tech. And it's amazing when you look down the rosters, particularly from an Alabama standpoint, how many head coaches, potential head coaches, played in the game.
You're right, Tom. You got Bill Battle, Charlie Pell, Richard Williamson, Jimmy Fuller. A lot of guys that you said came to be head coaches.
Well, a lot of future head coaches, a lot of great stars in this one. Let's go back to Grant Field in Atlanta, the year 1960, Crimson Tide of Alabama against the Yellow Jackets of Georgia Tech.
Richard Odell kicks it off for Alabama. Ben Smith at the nine for Tech. He gets only to the 15. Billy Richardson and Darwin Holt knock him down. Tech tries Smith on first down, only two. Leroy Jordan on the tackle. Then Smith again. Bama defense holds him to one. Jordan with help from Billy Neighbors and Charlie Pell. Possession down. Marvin Tibbetts gets the call for Tech. Stacked up, no gain. Jimmy Sharp and Bobby Boylston. Dodd sends in Don Coker to punt it away, but his kick travels only 18 yards. And Bama has great field position at the Tech 36. Bobby Skelton's at quarterback, not Pat Trammell. Skelton to Richardson on the first snap. He gets four. Again, it's Richardson for the Tide. This time, 2 yards to the Tech 30. On third down, Skelton wants to pass, but he's hit and fumbled. Willie McGahee recovers for Tech at the 37. The Yellow Jackets stay on the ground. Smith manages two. Jordan and Bill Battle stop him. On second down, Chick Granning meets Jordan for the first time, and Leroy drops him for a 3-yard loss. So on third down, Tech goes with a quick kick. Smith gets it away. Leon Fuller goes back to his own 27 to pick up the ball and returns it to the 36. Now it's Trammell at quarterback for the Tide. Off to Richardson. Bama, though, is penalized 15 yards back to the 21. So on first and long, Trammell keeps it himself with 3 yards to the 24. It's Trammell again, this time only a yard to the 25. Coach Bryant elects to kick on third down. Lauren Stapp is back there. He booms a 53-yarder. Jimmy Nail returns at 3 yards. Butch Wilson stops him at the 23. On first down, Tech goes with Granning. Jordan and Holt stop him after a gain of 3. Billy Williamson for Tech now. Holt's there to tackle him. Play makes 2. Possession down, Williamson won't be stopped this time. Races 36 yards to the Bama 36. Mike Fracchia finally brings him down. First and 10 now in Bama territory. Tech fans howling. Williamson gets it again. He's off once more. 11 this time. Holt makes the stop. Another first down, but Jordan holds Granning to only a yard. For the first time, Tech goes to the air. Stan Gann connects with Williamson for 7 yards. Eddie Versprilli, Fracchia drive him out of bounds at the Bama 17. Now the yardage really gets tough. Mike McNames gets only 1. Jordan and Joe Sissia knocking him down. On third down, McNames gets away for 4 yards and a first down. Norby Ronsonette and Fracchia stop him at the Bama 12. Again, it's McNames. Pell's there to get him, but he's to the 8. Quarterback Gann wants a touchdown, but he can't connect with Bob Solomon in the end zone. That brings up third down and goal to go at the 8-yard line. Look at Tech try the halfback pass. Granning rushed by Bill Reisenfeld at the 1. John Olinger intercepts for the Tide. He's out to the 6. So Bama holds off the Jackets. Appears to be in good shape, but on first down, Trammell, tackled by Smith, fumbles, and Tech's Rufus Guthrie recovers at the Bama 8-yard line. From that point, Tech only 1 play to score. Nail runs it in for the touchdown. On the extra point try, Billy Richardson comes crashing through to block Wells' kick. It's 6-0 Tech. Wells kicks off and drives Fuller back to his 7. Leon brings it out to the 26. On first down, Skelton coming to the near side, flips it to Fuller. He's knocked back for a 1-yard loss. Now it's Butch Wilson with the ball for the Tide, but he can get only 4 out to the 30. Again on third down, Stapp's in the punt. This time he sails it 39 yards. Nail rambles 15 before Jerry Spruill knocks him down at the 46. And that brings up the end of the first quarter. Bama trailing Tech, 6-0.
At first quarter, Jeff, was not exactly you want when you're on the road playing against a bitter rival. 15 yards in total offense, you fumble twice, one of them leads to a score. Not what you want to do, is it?
No, not especially when you're on the road, as you said. 15 yards total offense first quarter, you got to be thinking on the offensive side, what do we have to do to get going? But when you turn the ball over twice, as you said, it makes it tough.
Do nerves in a game like this play a role? I mean, do people literally get too uptight?
I think you do for the first few plays, but I think once you've taking that first hit, everything's fine. It's just a matter they just couldn't get things going.
Well, one of the guys who's trying to get things going is Pat Trammell. And before we get to the second quarter of this epic battle between Bama and Tech, let's talk a little bit more about the Tide's great quarterback in this game. Trammell, teammates of his are unanimous in their praise of a Scottsboro native that led Alabama to the national championship in 1961. Listen to Tommy Brooker talk about Pat Trammell.
Well, Pat was Coach Bryant on the field, and he was our general, he was our quarterback, and many times in the process of going in and off the football field, I've stood next to Coach Bryant and heard Coach Bryant say, well, Pat ought to run H 24 on this particular play, or maybe run a certain pass play on this particular play, and sure enough, they'd break, come out of the huddle, and they'd be running that play, because Pat envisioned the same game that Coach Bryant had prepared for us and knew it that well. He had the intelligence that he could convey it out on the football field, and that's the reason I say Pat was Coach Bryant physically playing out there on the football field. And And he was a general. And Coach Bryant gave him authority that if too many people were mealy-mouthing in the huddle, that he had the authority to quiet you and send you off the field. And he certainly didn't want to go off the field. People back in Demopolis, Alabama wouldn't understand that. Why did you go off the field, you know, right in the middle of a ball game? Well, it's because he was being disciplined. And Pat was very, very verbal in his display of generalship out on the football field, in that he had a knack at that time to cuss a lot. And in a few short words and a lot of words in the huddle, we never called a play. We had to go to the line of scrimmage. It looked like we were audible, but we were calling a play at the line of scrimmage because we just didn't have time to discipline about in the huddle. And there's some here at this little thing this weekend that Jimmy Wilson and Jimmy Sharp, these two little guards was, and I'm talking about little guards, 185-pound people that were going out there knocking some big heads off and everything. They come back in the huddle and won't talk about it. Well, that distracted from what we was trying to do in the huddle, and so consequence, you know, Pat Tran would have to verbally abuse them in the huddle and wouldn't have time to call the play. We'd go to line of scrimmage, call the play. But Pat was, you know, displayed the, the intelligence and the smartness that was required at that time in being a quarterback. But Pat was also a defensive secondary guy, too. A lot of people don't realize that, but my bunch, several on our team, our red team was a two-way team. I played offensive end and also left defensive end. So Pat Trammell played in the defensive secondary because Pat was also an agitator, you know. He'd aggravate you in the shower or in the training room or in the dressing room, and just keep things stirred up.
Heading into the second quarter, Alabama against Georgia Tech back in 1962, let's talk about quarterbacks and Jeff Rutledge, particularly Coach Bryant's philosophy about how he used quarterbacks. In this game, for instance, Pat Tremble's the star. Bobby Skelton started. Trammell comes in. I think even a third quarterback got some time in the first half. You played quarterback in the Coach Bryant. What was his thinking there?
I didn't realize he played as many quarterbacks as he did until I watched this tape. Back in the 60s, he was playing, as you said, two, three quarterbacks a game. I thought he only did it when he got to the wishbone. Can't argue with Coach Bryant's success. I think he just tried to get new faces in the game, new quarterbacks in the game, see if it could perk up the offense, and things weren't going well, he'd try somebody else.
Well, did he always have a number one quarterback, a guy who really was the clutch guy?
He had his starter, and he would go with him. If things weren't going well, though, he was quick to pull him out. And nowadays, you would guess, you know, second guess that decision that a coach would make on his quarterbacks. But how could you second guess Coach Bryant?
Well, in this particular game, especially because the guy who starts, that's the second string quarterback, has to come in and play the hero when it's over. We'll get to that. Right now, let's go back to Atlanta. Trammell and Skelton leading Alabama against Georgia Tech.
Tech has the ball at its own 46 to start the second quarter. Granning is on the toss. Now he gets four to midfield. Richardson and Boylston on the tackle. Granning tries again, but Boylston stops him again, along with Frakia, a gain of two. Third down now, and Williamson goes for seven and a first down before Holt makes the stop. Now Tech goes to the far side. Smith for three. No, he's knocked down by Bobby Skelton, a loss of three on the play. Tech looking to pass now. Gans back. Rush by Ronsonette. Release to Granning for 11 yards. Frakia tackles him. Still, the Jackets are a yard shy of a first down. Smith gets that, and one more. Holt and Don Martin put him down. First and 10 at the Bama 21. Gann again to the air. Granning has it for 10 yards to the 21. Skelton on the tackle. Now it's Granning for Tech, but the Jackets are penalized. 15 yards back to the 34. So Gann drops back to pass. Gets a rush from Battle, completes it to Williamson. He gets six before Versprilli pulls him down. Bama steps up the defensive pressure. Gann rushed hard by Boylston and Jack Rutledge. He throws incomplete. On third down, Gann drops back to pass. He gets away from Charlie Pell, but he's chased down by Boylston and Neighbors. A loss of three, back to the 30. So Tech's forced to go for three. Wells gets a good snap and a spot, and his 47-yard attempt is good. The Yellow Jackets are now out in front of Bama, 9-0. Wells kicks off to Fuller, this time at the Bama 2. And Leon rambles out to the 22. On first down, it's Richardson going for two to the 24. Richardson again, this time for four, out to the 28. Third down and four, Trammell back to pass, wants to hit Tommy White. It's incomplete. Bama still doesn't have a first down. So Stapps back to punt for the third time this afternoon. He booms it 45 yards. Williamson on the return for Tech. He gets 10 to the 37, but there's a 15-yard walk-off against the Jackets back to their own 17. It's Granning on first down for Tech. Odell stops him after a gain of only two. Now watch this play. Nail, good blocking, even against Jordan, but Leroy gets the tackle anyway, a gain of five. Third and three, Gann heads around in and gets the first down, a gain of nine, and he's finally chased out of bounds. Here comes Nail again, getting five, Sissia and Moore on the stop. Granning with the ball, but he finds Holt and Olinger waiting on him. A loss of one on the play. Third down, Nail can manage only two. Rutledge is there to stop him. So here comes Coker for his third punt of the afternoon. It's 36 yards to White, who makes the fair catch at the 25. Bryant goes to Skelton again at quarterback. He's back to pass, but gets sacked, an 8-yard loss back to the 17. On second down, Billy Piper gets only two out to the 19. Then Bama's call for delay, 5 yards back to the 14. So on third down, Skelton wants to go to White. It's knocked down by the Tech defense. So Stapps on to punt for the fourth time. He gets away a good 44-yarder. But Granning is off on a good return for Tech. He breezes 19 yards before Rutledge finally stops him at the Bama 39. Time to air it out for Tech. Gann completes it to Granning for 15 yards to the Bama 24. On second down, Gann back, looking for Anderson. Richardson almost intercepts it for the tie. Third down, Gann connects this time with Anderson. It's good for 21 to the Bama 3. Fuller in battle, stop him short of the end zone. But on first down, Gann won't be stopped. He's in for a 3-yard score. Just over a minute to play now, and here's a big play for Alabama. Wells' kick is no good. Tech has a 15-0 lead and is dominating Alabama. Again, the Wells kick off to Wilson at the 4. Has problems with it, picks it up, returns it to the 20. That's where Bama starts its final possession of the first half. It's Stapp now who comes on at quarterback. And here's the first down of the afternoon. Stapp going for 12 yards himself, out to the 32. Stapp tries it again, just 2 yards this time to the 34. And we come to the final play of the first half. Tech stops Stapp after just a yard. So we go to the Grant Field locker room. It's Georgia Tech 15, Alabama nothing.
We're at the end of the first half, and Jeff Rutledge, I can't imagine a worse first half. One first down, 34 yards total offense for Alabama.
Had their troubles.
Yeah.
But they only attempted two passes. You sit there and you think, if you're a fan, a quarterback in the stands, why aren't you trying to throw the football? It's easy to stop a, an offensive team if you know all they're going to do is run. And Georgia Tech just sat up there and waited on that run, and they never even tried to throw the football.
And on the defensive side, not a good half either. Of course, the offense helped Georgia Tech out a little bit with a turnover, but you give up 15 points. I would think in Coach Bryant's mind, that's too many points for a game.
Exactly. And going into halftime, I'm sure Coach Bryant let them have it.
I would think so. Well, headed to halftime, as we said, Alabama's behind 15 to nothing. But Tide players like Leroy Jordan were confident, mainly because of the man leading their offense, Pat Trammell. Listen to Leroy talking about Pat.
Yeah, Pat Trammell was a great leader. He had that fire and enthusiasm, take charge kind of guy, which you love in a quarterback. He was a hard nosed, more like a linebacker than he was a quarterback as far as his attitude toward football. But he was the guy in charge when he was on the field, and you felt like that he was the leader, and whatever Pat called, whatever play, we did our job, it would work. And he was not the great passer that some of the other guys were, but he threw the ball to the guy that was open, and he made the key plays when he had to. And he was just an outstanding person, and just would love for him to be at a function like this, you know, because it would mean so much to all of us. But he was just a great leader, a great person, and, you know, went on to get his doctor's degree and get ready to practice medicine before it happened. But he was a catalyst in our early years of development.
We're headed into the second half, and Alabama's down 15 to nothing. Jeff Rutledge, what do you think the locker room might have been at halftime? What do you think the scene might have been there?
Well, we can only speculate. I know when I played, if you're down at halftime, he comes in and really acts the opposite of what you would think. But I got to believe back in 1960, he went in and he chewed them out. 34 yards total offense, give up 15 points, as you mentioned. I don't think Coach Bryant was too happy, and I think he let the guys know it.
What kind of adjustments would he make? Would Coach Bryant typically be the one who made those adjustments, or would he look to his assistants?
I can only, again, go when I played. He let the assistants do the work. He pretty much got them in a huddle, told them what he wanted, and they would come and make the adjustments.
Well, whatever the adjustments might be, Alabama's behind by 15 going into the second half. I kind of feel that the players themselves felt like they could come back and win. Tommy Brooker, for instance, told me that Coach Bryant made you believe you could win.
Well, I think in making you believe in yourself and going out there every day and telling you that even though some days you may only put out 80%, that the next day you had to put out 120. And that was making up. If it was 90%, you put out 110% the next day. And the attitude of doing 110%, in my opinion, always prevailed. You were very conscientious about trying to achieve beyond, you know, the your own means. He made us believe in ourselves. He made us believe that we could walk through a wall. I've always used that statement and indicating that today's athletes, if you tell them to try to go through a wall, they'd rather go around it than go through it. Well, he made us believe we could go through it. And he took a little of nothing, because we were not the greatest athletes, I'm sure, in the world at the time that we came to the University of Alabama, but he made us believe in ourselves. So to each one of us, he got the 110% out every day in his own way. Different guys and different people, and he could do that.
So Brooker and his teammates knew they could come back and win it, so let's get back to Atlanta and Bama's 1960 rally against Georgia Tech. In the second half, Tech a chance to build on its 15-point lead as Odell kicks to Smith, and he gets it out to the 36. Holtz on the tackle for Bama. On first down, Granning gets four, but look at the good gang tackling by the Tide defense. Now it's Gann for the Jackets, but they're penalized 5 yards. The ball's back at the 35. On third down, Gann misses his handoff. Jordan's there to drop him for a 2-yard loss. Now Bobby Dodd makes a punting change. Gerald Birch is on to kick it away. And Fuller makes the fair catch for Bama at the 35. After a run and a penalty, Bama second and 11 at the 34. Big play. Rockia rambles for 13 before he's stopped by Granning.
Mike tries it again. This time he has two. Looks like the tide's ready to roll, but a 15-yard penalty on this play puts Bama back at its own 35. So Skelton has to pass. Tack knows it, and the Jackets tackle him for no gain. Staff averaged better than 45 yards in the first half. This time he kicks it 41 to Wenninger. He's going to get eight on the return to the 32. Tech's most used running back is Granning. He gets the ball here, but Boylston gets him after a pickup of two. Zolly Searcy gets his first crack, but it's Butch Wilson who does the cracking for the tie. So Tech decides to punt on third down. It's just a 14-yard kick this time by Birch. Brocchio makes the fair catch at the Tech 49. Now we're well into the third quarter, and Bama's still scoreless. Brocchio tries to get it started, getting three to the Tech 46. But on second down, Trammell loses nine back to the Bama 45. Ed Nutting on the sack. Third and 16 to go. Fuller gets away on a 16-yard scamper. He has a first down at the Tech 39. Again, it's Rocky up for Bama. This time, Mike gets three. Bama comes running back to the line of scrimmage this time. Ty wanting a score. Trammell drops back to pass. Hits Fuller, and he goes all the way to the 18. A gain of 18 on the play, and Bama is the closest it's been all afternoon. Now it's Trammell on the run. He's got a dozen to the Tech's 6-yard line. First and goal for the Tide. Trammell again, this time only 2 yards. Second down at the 4. Frakia gets Bama a yard closer. Third down. Fuller makes two, but he stopped at the 1-yard line. When you're down by 15, you have to go for it. Fuller does and gets it. He's into the end zone. Let's look at the replay. After over 40 minutes of action, the Tide finally has some points thanks to blocking of the line and on the end and Fuller's nice run. Now Trammell tries to pass for a 2-point conversion here. It's incomplete, but at long last, Bama's on the board. Still trailing Tech 15-6. 3 minutes left in the third. Odell kicks again to Searcy. He returns it 27 yards before Olinger stops him at the 30. On first down, it's Olinger making the play again. Searcy, though, gets 6 yards before John stops him. McNames next for Tech. He gets 3 yards to the 39. Stapp on the tackle. Third and one, Granning for the first down despite good tackles by Jordan and Versprilli. Searcy tries again. Roy Holsom back, fights off a blocker, stops him at the line. Again looking to pass on second down. He fires, but Moore's there to knock it down for Bama. Third down now. Granning gets only three thanks to the defense of Jordan and Sharp. And Tech's ready to punt as we head to the fourth quarter. Bama still on the short end of a 15-6 score.
After three quarters now, Alabama's finally into this football game, and Jeff, it's kind of good to see the Tide finally get back into the thing.
Well, you got to be standing on the sidelines feeling a little better about your chances of winning, especially after that first half. But Pat Trammell's getting ready to do some things.
Well, let's look at what Pat Trammell, a couple of the things he did in the third quarter of this one. Nice pass here to Leon Fuller.
Yes, he looked like he was decided he was going to turn up and run, but then he looks out in the flat and sees Fuller and makes a great throw.
Then the next play we look at from Trammell, he does run.
Almost like a quarterback draw. I think he went back to pass and then saw a big opening in the middle and just took off, and look at the extra effort he was giving.
Well, he led Alabama to a touchdown in the third quarter. In the fourth, we see, though, that the comeback's going to fall on the shoulders of Trammell's backup, Bobby Skelton. Now, if he was nervous, Skelton didn't show it. But after all, as he told me, under Coach Bryant, you were prepared for everything.
They were a lot and very close together. we had a lot of practices, and I remember that we Coach Bailey came in early, and we all were in the dorm, and Coach Bailey was a center and quarterback coach, and we had to go downstairs, and for about an hour and a half or 2 hours every night, and everybody had to have this, had to put our hands on the center the same way and the same amount of pressure. And we had about six centers and six quarterbacks, and we'd just rotate around, and everybody's sound had to be the same pitch. It was a kind of a deep sound, and he coached us on our sound, and the sound of the ball when it hit in the quarterback's hand, it had to be a thud. And that was just one of the little simple things like that. And if that ball didn't hit in there just right, it would fall straight down. And he just worked on little things. He didn't want, if it was a bad snap, he didn't want it going all over the field. It'd just fall straight down. So that was a long, hard practice session late at night doing those center quarterback drills.
Probably one of the greatest comebacks in Alabama football history. The Tide against Georgia Tech in 1960, Grant Field in Atlanta. We're ready to go to the fourth quarter. Jeff Rutledge, I figure there's some guys out there bound to be getting whipped about this time because they're going both ways and have been all day.
That's impressive to see guys, your quarterback's playing defense, then he plays offense. You got your lineman doing the same thing, running backs doing the same thing. Very impressive that they can hold up and play as well as they did in the fourth quarter.
We'll go back to 60 in a minute, but when you came along in high school even, did you play both ways in high school?
No, I could only do one thing, and that was play quarterback.
Well, one of the guys who's going to play quarterback a lot here in the fourth quarter is Bobby Skelton. As we mentioned, Pat Trammell injured, so Skelton's got to take over at quarterback. What does that do? Perhaps does the fact that he's been playing defense help him a little bit, and he's already in the swing of things. Doesn't have to get warmed up for darn sure.
Plus, he started a football game. Mm-hmm. So he's already played some quarterback. Like you said, he's fresh. He's ready to go. But he's filling in for Pat Trammell. Fourth quarter, you're behind, and he has to be ready to play. And you have to give him credit for coming in and doing a great job.
As a backup, is that the kind of position you'd want to be in?
You know, as a backup, that's your job. You know you're going to come in, and they expect you to bring the team from behind or keep the lead or whatever the situation is in the ball game. And I think he came in and did his job.
Go to the other side of the football for a minute. The defense gave up that 15 in the first half. They know there's no way they can give up a point here in the second half.
Exactly. Coach Bryant's talking at halftime, must work.
Yeah, must have. Well, we're going to go. You've got the background. Let's see the final part of the Bama comeback as we go back to 1960, Grant Field in Atlanta, Bama beating Georgia Tech.
Tech starts the fourth quarter with Coker kicking it away to Bama. His 37-yarder is taken by Fuller, but he's hit immediately. Tide's first play of the final quarter. Let's look at Vrakia. He breaks away for a 15-yard gain. Look at Mike Run. First down again. This time Wilson's dropped for a 2-yard loss. Then it's Vrakia for it, no gain. So it's a big third down coming for the Tide. And Skelton's got a big play coming. He gets loose for 11 yards out to the 44, still a yard shy of a first down. So Bama goes for it on fourth down. Vrakia gets the call. 4 yards, the drive's alive at the 48. Now with Trammell injured, it's Skelton's game to win. He misses on one pass, but he's going to hit this one. Jerry Spruill gets it all the way to the Tech 24, a pickup of 26 on the play. Mike Vrakia again, this time for 4 yards. On second down, Skelton rambling, 12 yards. The Tide has it first and goal at the Jackets 8. Skelton dropping back to pass on this time, and he hits Ronsonette for the touchdown. An 80-yard drive and 10 plays, taking about 6 minutes. Look at the touchdown from a wider angle. Skelton to Ronsonette to start Bama's fourth quarter comeback. Odell's on to kick the extra point, and now the Tide trails by only 2, 15-13.
After kicking out of bounds, Odell boots it again for Bama to Granning at his 9. Chick brings it upfield. Bill Rice belts him down. The ball's loose, but Granning falls on it. Bama's defense, though, is ready for the Jackets. Rice and Holt hammer nail for a 2-yard loss. Gann carries it next. Sharp's there for the tackle, but Tech is penalized back to the 15. So Granning has to pass. Holt blitzes, forces him outside. Jordan and Fracchia waiting. No gain. On third down, Coker lines up in punt formation, but he passes to Granning, who picks up 11 yards, but the Jackets are still short of a first down. Now this time, Coker does punt it away, a 41-yarder. White has it for the tie at the Bama 37. We're midway the fourth quarter now. Bama needs a score. Skelton tries a pass, but it's broken up by the Jackets. So the Tide goes back to the ground, and Frocky gets 4 out to the 41. On third down, Skelton passing again. Granning breaks it up. Bama wanted interference, but nothing is called. Tide goes for it on fourth down. Skelton back to pass. Again, though, it's off target. So Tech takes over at the Bama 40, and the defense gets another test. Olinger responds, stopping Gann for a yard. On second down, Gann fumbles, but recovers. The play loses 2. Possession play for Tech now. Searcy getting only 2. He's stopped by Rutledge at the 39. So Coker's in, punting it away, wanting to go out of bounds, but it goes into the end zone, and Bama has it at its own 20 with 3:21 to go. Tide's first play. Fuller picks up 3 yards. Now it's Skelton dropping back to pass. White, gain of 7, a first down Bama. We have 2:41 left in the game. Skelton trying to hit Ronsonette this time. It's incomplete. Second down, Bobby again on the pass to Norby. And again, not complete. So on third down, really big play for the Tide. And Skelton's back again. Finally, he connects. It's Fuller for 9 out to the 39. But we have 2:23 to go, and it's 4th-and-1 for Bama. Fuller on the carry gets a huge yard. First down at the 40. Bama's moving now toward what would be a winning score. Skelton hits battle. Play picks up 18 yards. The Tide's in Jacket territory at the 42. 1:34 left. Skelton tries to hit Piper. No go on the play. On second down, Skelton pass intended for battle. Incomplete. Third down now for the Tide. Tech defense knows Skelton's going to pass, so Birch breaks through, sacks Bobby for a loss of 3 to the 45. 58 seconds left. Fourth down. Skelton back to pass. Finds Ronsonette open. Combination works for 13 yards and a first down at the Tech 32. Clock rolling again. 32 seconds to go. Skelton rolls right. Lots of pressure. Finds Wilson on the Jacket's 6-yard line. Let's look at a replay on this one. Watch Skelton move as far as he can to the far sideline. Put up against the chalk as he gets a great pass away to Wilson. Bama has it 1st and goal at the 6. On the sidelines, Coach Bryant taps Odell for the kick. Clock moving, under 10 seconds. Olinger snaps, Skelton puts it down, Richard kicks, and it's good!
Well, that one definitely deserves a second look. Odell subbing for the injured Tommy Brooker kicks the 24-yard field goal. Bama's gone 80 yards in 13 plays, going for it on two fourth down situations. And the Tide has posted one of its greatest comebacks ever. From a 15-point deficit, Bama rallies the final. Alabama 16, Georgia Tech 15.
It was hectic, it was frantic, and it definitely came down to the last minute, Jeff Rutledge, as Alabama beats Georgia Tech 16-15. Just for a moment, let's talk about that last-second field goal by Odell. Now, he kicked it, but there's a lot of other folks that combined to make that a winning field goal.
Well, anytime it comes down to the end like that, the pressure's on all three guys, the snapper, the holder, and the kicker. Snapper is sitting there saying, let's snap a good snap. The holder's sitting there saying, let's not drop it, because I've been there and I have dropped it. Then the kicker's saying, please, just let me make it. And this is the first field goal this guy's ever kicked.
Well, and to go back to the holder for a second, you were talking as we were getting ready to go into this final segment about the fact that Skelton and Bobby Skelton did hold for this the final kick, that the fact that he's been in the ball game kind of helps him.
It definitely helps, because he hasn't been over on the sidelines doing nothing. His hands are used to getting a snap from center, so they're used to having the football on his hands, mm-hmm. and it makes it a lot easier to hold.
Well, that was the winning points, but let's go back and look at some of the other highlights from this football game. And really, from an Alabama standpoint, they started in the second half with Pat Trammell. This is a great pass here.
Great pass. He had to turn up and hits the back out in the flat, and great effort there to run over one guy and get as much yards as he can.
It was Leon Fuller, and Fuller now is going to get the touchdown. That was Alabama's first of the football game, came in the third quarter. Now you got Bobby Skelton in there in the backup role. Great pass here to Norby Ronsonette for the touchdown.
Fakes to the back, and just tight end gets behind the secondary, and he drops it right over the top.
This is a brilliant piece of work by Skelton. Look at him. He goes right up against the sidelines to throw this pass.
And then just before he gets out of bounds, once again gets it right over the defensive back's head.
Butch Wilson catches it, gets it close enough for Richard Odell to come in and kick the field goal. Alabama beats Georgia Tech. And Jeff, I want to go back to that Skelton play on the sidelines. I mean, as a quarterback, that's tough to just roll out, and then ultimately you got that sideline, you got to do something with the football.
You're either going to go ahead and get knocked out of bounds or run out of bounds, but a lot of times what happens, and what I was impressed with Skelton was that a lot of times in that situation you force the ball. You try to make something happen, getting ready to run out of bounds, and you panic. Mm-hmm. He held his composure and just made a great soft throw over the top of the defense and wins the game.
Well, he was standing right up at the line of scrimmage, too, that I noticed, because the official standing there at the line of scrimmage, the ref there spotted it. Downfield, as I understand it, Butch Wilson ran out of bounds, came back in, and caught that pass.
Which we all know you cannot do.
Yes.
And once again, that's Coach Bryant's luck. He's known to get all the breaks, and he definitely got one there.
Now, wait a second. Coach Bryant's luck. I've heard of it down through the years, and I believe it. But isn't luck the product of some hard work, too?
Well, they say you create your own luck or your own breaks, and I think that's a lot of truth to that. But in that situation right there, I mean, how many officials you have in a ball game and nobody sees it? So there's a lot of luck involved in that one.
Well, and I would just assume any time you come from 15 points down and win a football game, there's got to be a little luck in your career. What's the best comeback you ever had?
By far, the game I played in Detroit when I was with the Washington Redskins. We were down 24 points in the third quarter, and it was sort of like, well, we're going to put this guy in, see what he can do. And somehow we came back and won it in overtime.
Luck? Hard work?
I think a lot of it was stupidity on the defensive part, because we were so far behind. They played prevent defense the whole second half and allowed us to just march down the field.
Well, I guess it takes a lot all the way around. Well, this has been a great one, a great comeback, probably the greatest in the history of Alabama football, as the Tide comes from behind to beat Georgia Tech 16-15. Truly one of the greatest games in Alabama football history.